It looks good. All right. So, please proceed whenever you're ready.
Okay. It's a new year. L'Shana Tova. I miss seeing you. This seems so strange. It seems so unnatural. Whatever happened to all the weeks, even the months that just passed? We look at the calendar and poof, they were gone. They flew away, but the hours of the day take longer. We miss everything we can't do, but today it's a new year, so we think about a fresh start. So let's bless this precious moment. Yehi ratzon milfanecha, Adonai Eloheinu v'Elohei Avoteinu, shatchadesh aleinu shana tova u'metuka. May it be thy will, O God and God of our ancestors, to renew us all. Give us a good and a sweet year. God's blessings be upon you and those you love for a year of health and safety and peace. We applaud the work of Rabbi Miller, Cantor Azu, Rabbi Boxman, and Deborah Fidel, of the whole temple leadership and staff, for successfully holding everything together so that today we can turn to the serious work of Teshuvah, of return with understanding. And of course, Rabbi Miller, thanks for inviting me back. Eventually, not tomorrow, but eventually, we will be returning to whatever normal is going to look like by then. For now, we've grown weary of the screaming headlines. I'm worried. I'm worried about America. And I'm worried about Israel. And I'm worried about rising anti-Semitism and other kinds of racism. I'm worried about COVID. I'm worried about climate change. Rosh Hashanah invites us to worry less. Worrying doesn't help. Let hopeful, positive thoughts light our path to the future. We will take truth and wisdom wherever we find it. My current favorite musical is Hamilton. And I especially love the scene when Alexander Hamilton and George Washington have this little conversation. And Hamilton confides that he wishes he could command some troops and achieve military glory. But the older and wiser President Washington replies, "Let me tell you what I wish I'd known when I was young and dreamed of glory. You have no control who lives, who dies, who tells your story." Does this remind you of a certain prayer this morning? That's the one that goes, "Who shall live and who shall die?" It makes us feel uncomfortable every year. It should. It reflects all of our uncertainty about life, the economy, our community, our education system, everything. Especially our poor old country's torn social fabric. Barry Weiss, who used to write for the New York Times, called it the great unraveling. Sometimes things really are unraveling. It doesn't help that everybody seems angry. Whatever happened to civility? Whatever happened to respectful listening? Is power ever a substitute for truth? And add to that so many feeling depressed and anxious and fearful, not to mention unemployed, in financial distress, and there is even hunger, yes, hunger, in the wealthiest nation in the world. And of course, pandemic. I was talking to my doctor recently, and I asked him, did you learn about pandemic in medical school? And he said, yes, we did. We knew it was coming. We just didn't know when it was going to happen. And now it is happening. We add to our list. And who by COVID-19? And we are helpless. We can't control much of anything, at least not yet. Now back to President Washington. We have no control over who lives, who dies, nor can we control how our story gets told, or who tells it, or how they tell it, or even if they tell it. But Rosh Hashanah reminds us that you are the only one who gets to write that story. You are the one to create a true record. We are asked, how well are you writing it? We want to be our best selves. How do we do that? By actually living it. That's what this day tells us. How your story gets written, that's the question. How shall we record our return to life? We want to return to our best selves, to honesty, to generosity, to love, to fairness, to courage, to all our good intentions. It's not just to shape a legacy. It is to make our present lives as full and rich and effective as we can possibly make them while we're still alive. We ask that we be inscribed in the book of life. It's not for one more year. It's not for more time before we die. It is for better, richer, fuller years of real living. Everybody dies, but not everybody gets to live. We want to be among those who do. That's our job today, figuring out how to do that. The ancient rabbis used days like this so they could reimagine the past. It's about good memories. This way they could relive the experience year after year. The past becomes ours through the words and the music when we speak those words, when we hear that music. We have it available to us now, but how we receive it isn't always clear. Things seem very uncertain, very dark, murky. But as the philosopher Kierkegaard once said, faith sees best in the dark. Well, we're in the dark, all right. It's harder this year without being in temple. We miss services. We miss seeing each other. Our synagogue is a big part of our lives. Even when we're not there, it's comforting just to know that it's there. But we need to remember, not even our beautiful temple is the answer. It is just a reminder of the teachings that we want to live by. We have something our ancestors didn't. And I don't mean the most powerful, advanced technology ever invented. We have opportunities to do things that were never possible before. Pandemic allows us to see something new and new possibilities, a potential for good, our challenge to repair the world. Since this pandemic started, we rediscovered how much we really are social animals. We need each other. We learned how important family and dear ones are to us. Everybody was so busy before. Now people actually talk. Our solitude helps us discover how bad loneliness feels. But we also discovered that it can be useful. There are good things to do, good things to read, some good TV, good music, endless opportunities to learn, especially about ourselves. Most of all, we discovered how much we should treasure the people we live with. Garrison Keillor wrote that we should require some quarantine in order to get a marriage license. If you're still speaking after a month or two, then your relationship has a future and you can get married. About that word teshuvah, return. Here's a little Hebrew lesson. There are two different meanings to the word. The first means to return to the familiar straight path you started out on, your best intentions. Our cantor sings a lovely song, return to the land of your soul. You're coming home after a period of absence. Jewishly, many of us have been absent for some time, but you can fix that, by the way. The second meaning comes from the word to respond. In Hebrew, the word teshuvah also means an answer. You're responding to a summons. You are summoned to return to your natural best self. Teshuvah is both a return and a personal response to a divine call. How we respond is our story. Again, who tells your story? You do, by the way you live your life. Now let me be clear. We Jews are notorious for not accepting the inevitable. After all, against all odds, we're still here. So if you happen to have our new Reform prayer book, look at page 178 at the top. These words, on Rosh Hashanah it is written, on Yom Kippur it is sealed. That's pretty clear, isn't it? It's unavoidable, it's written down. It's already recorded in the Holy Scroll, the heavenly scroll for the coming year. But see what's at the top of 180, the very next page. It says, but through return to the right path, through prayer and righteous giving, we can transcend the harshness of this decree. So the inevitable isn't necessarily inevitable. You can still do something. You can always do something. You can start now. Reach out to those people you've been thinking about. Say the words that you should say. Give even more money to the Harry Chapin Food Bank. People near you, are hungry. Bring yourself closer to that person you want to be, that person you ought to be. We don't have to accept what seems inevitable. We don't have to sink into despair. And certainly we're not going to give up. Today we say, help us return to you, and we can get there. Hashiveinu Adonai v'nashuva. We know there will be a lot to do when things get better. We can't allow our physical distance now to become our psychological distance then. We don't ask for it to be easy, only to know that it's possible. We ask for God's helping hand to guide us, to protect those we love. We've got to rebuild our world. And as we rebuild it, you'll see, we'll strengthen ourselves as well. When we are strong, we make each other strong. So, be strong, my friends, and be safe, you and everyone you care about. And then come back for a Shana Tova Umetuka, a good and a sweet year.